Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning. A special welcome to our guests today. I am Pastor Deb Grismer, and it is a joy to see everybody this morning in worship. Thank you for your patience. I will fully admit my humanness in that I was having a little trouble getting my act together this morning. So thank you for your patience. I appreciate that. If you look in your bulletin, before I do the rest of the announcements, one of the things that was one of our New Year's resolutions from the worship committee was that we introduce a new liturgy this year and start working towards having our full liturgy. Yes, Linda, this is your fault. Okay, in case you were wondering, Linda. So we're going to introduce two of the pieces today, and I'd like to just practice them a little bit before we get there. The first one is the gospel acclamation, which if you take the red book and look in the front on page 151 in the front of the book, you will see the Alleluia. The words are the same. The tune is a little different. For those of you who were used to doing multiple liturgies out of the green book, I believe, what did we decide? This was setting number one or two? Two in the green book. And so we're going to listen to it once, and then we will sing through it once, and then we'll sing it again as the gospel acclamation. And Connie, let's just try it with the melody. Okay? So you will give us a chord to start with, right? Okay? Familiar to anyone? Oh, look, we got like half the crowd here. We're good. And then if you would turn to your beginning of your service music, so hymn number 184, okay, you'll see Let the Vineyards in the service music, okay. Let's just play the melody once. Okay, together. Gather the harvest from the seeds that were sown, that we may be fed with the bread of life. Oh, there was a few laughing at that. Okay. For those who are wondering, these are from setting four in the red hymnal for you church nerds out there, in case you're wondering. And those are the two new pieces we're going to do for a few weeks, and then we'll add another new piece. And then pretty soon everybody will be like, haven't we been singing this forever? Right? Right. Because I am confident and have faith. Martin, why are you smiling? You don't have confidence and faith in that? All right, so that will come during the worship service. That will come during the worship service. A couple of announcements that I'd like to make.
I probably should have a bulletin.
Poinsettias are ready to be taken home. I forgot to set this out last week, so if you already took your poinsettia home, please cross your name off the list so we know who to call and bug about taking their poinsettia home. There's a few names on the back. And so help yourself after worship today for that. And I think behind the altar there's some sacks yet for those who want to put their poinsettia in a sack to take home. Our next Sunday, we are planning a financial mission plan forum after worship. Our annual meeting reports will be ready next Sunday for you to take home. And then on the 9th, so if you'd like to look through that and visit with somebody, Mike and others will be downstairs kind of in the back fellowship hall, that you can visit with them ahead of time about finances, proposed mission plan, any of you can visit about any of the committee reports, things we might be talking about. It'll just be a good place to sit for those who would like some more information ahead of time. And then our annual meeting will be January 19th. And I'm excited for that. It will happen after worship. And then we will have this soup and chili cook-off. So if anybody wants to bring a crock pot of soup to have as part of the cook-off, you are welcome to just bring it, have it available downstairs, and we'll have soup to eat and beans to use so that you can vote for your favorite. I believe Richard won last year. Am I wrong? Okay, this is a mistake. Yep, the 12th is the forum for those who would like more information. The 19th is the meeting. Thank you. That's what I get for not looking close enough. And you did win last year, Richard, didn't you?
Sure.
I believe I did not. I'm pretty sure he did, because I have to glue the trophy back together because you never took it home with you and I never got a picture of you with it.
I can say my name's on there a couple times.
Yep. I think you beat Rodney's 2 years out in a row, I think. Yep. Yep.
Except when somebody brings real cream and puts it in theirs, that's the years I lose out.
That's the years you lose out, the real cream years? Yeah. Who does that?
Well, that's what I needed to know, is what I needed to bring to win.
Bring to win? Apparently it's chili with real cream?
Yeah, was it? Didn't you? Oh, what did she bring last year?
Who are you? Mickey?
Carol.
Carol? Linda?
Carol.
Carol? Do you put real cream in yours?
It was white chili.
White chili.
She brought in like whole
jar, I see,
cream.
Of cream to put in your white chili. Huh.
Not last year.
2 years, year before, anyway, some year. Okay, now you know what to win.
Yes, I just say I am a sore loser if you can't tell.
Yeah. So you won't bring one? Carol, I don't think you need to do that.
Well, I can't win this year, so that's the way we've done it.
That's the way we've done it. Yeah, we just change off, and, you know, it all works out just fine. Bring whatever you want. I will bring non-chili, because I have decided West River doesn't like my chili because it's too mild. So I will bring a different soup. I don't know what yet. It's not Saturday night at midnight, so I'm not sure what I'm bringing yet. Dog night starts again this week, and our Hermosa Fairburn Community Food Bank Super Bowl is fundraiser is also coming up. All right, let's take a minute just to breathe, for me to breathe, as we listen to the bell and welcome the Holy Spirit to worship. Please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, love from the beginning, word made flesh, breath of heaven.
Amen.
Let us confess our sinfulness before God and one another, trusting in God's endless mercy and love. Merciful God, we confess that we are not perfect. We have said and done things we regret. We have tried to earn your redeeming grace while denying it to others. We have resisted your call to be your voice in the world. Forgive us, loving God. Give us righteousness, the strength to put aside our failures, and the courage to try again. Amen. Dear people of God, hear the good news. Christ the Savior is born. You are loved and forgiven in the name of Jesus who has come among us. You are freed from proving that you deserve to be loved because God's love is given to you as the most precious gift of all. Rejoice in this love and share it with the world. Amen. We sing together hymn number 300, The First Noel.
Lay
of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you revealed your Son to the nations by the leading of a star. Lead us now by faith to know your presence in our lives and bring us at last to the full vision of your glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our scripture reading will read responsibly, I the light color. And it comes from Psalms 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth shall change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns. The nations are in an uproar. The kingdoms totter. He utters his voice. The earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord. See what desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Remain seated, please. Our gospel reading is from Matthew, the second chapter, beginning with the first verse. Glory to you, O Lord. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is this child who has been born King of the Jews? For we have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all of Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So we have some special guests today, and I would invite them to come up at this time to share their thoughts with you.
I know. You never know what's going to happen around here. I can't get the other handheld.
Did you pray about it?
You're right. I didn't pray about the other microphone.
I'll work on that this week, God. I promise.
Did you push it all the way over?
I think so.
Okay.
You ready?
I'm ready.
All right, let's go.
Balthazar, would you stop with that chewing noise already? I can't hear myself think over here. Where's Gaspar? By the way, he was supposed to be here by now. We're supposed to tell all these beautiful people our story.
Don't worry, boss. He'll be here. You know how Gaspar is. He probably took a couple of wrong turns on that last sand dune. Zero sense of direction, that one.
What are you eating?
Avocado sandwich. Want a bite?
I'm from the East, not East California. Put that thing away. The smell of the healthy food makes me nervous. Hey, there he is, Mr. Navigator himself.
Sorry, boss, I got turned around. No stars out tonight, you know.
And that, my friend, is why you rode all the way in the caboose to Bethlehem.
Yeah. I know, my sense of direction is a little murky. Get it, huh? Murky?
You're hilarious, Gaspar. Hilarious. But I still think my gift is the best. Sweet-smelling frankincense. And boy, did they need it. It smelled like a barn in there.
Yeah, but leave it to me. Head of the family to pick the best gift. Gold. That's what a king deserves, you know. Nothing but the best for the long-awaited Messiah.
Gaspar, here was the first one to see the star, but I had already been studying the prophecies of old for years.
Yeah, Balthazar, you're a real wise guy.
No, I'm a wise man. So we packed our camels, said goodbye to the family, and started following the star.
It was so bright that it shone in the middle of the day.
Lucky for you, Marco Polo.
And God not only hung the star in the sky for us, he also protected us from Herod's schemes.
We trusted Herod at first.
Hey, when the king invites you to his palace for a free Italian food buffet, you don't say no.
He told us to find the child and report back to him so that he too could bring gifts and worship the baby himself.
But I saw right through Herod's lies, and I asked Tony if we were really going to give him directions to the newborn king. And you know what he said? Tell him what you said, boss.
I said, forget about it.
Yeah, forget about it.
So we continued following the star until we found the child safe in his mother and father's care.
And we laid our gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh before the king and worshipped him. Isn't that right, boss?
It was a beautiful thing. I still get teary-eyed just thinking about it.
And God kept us safe from Herod's prying eyes as we gathered food and supplies before the long journey home. So many things could have gone wrong if it weren't for God's miracle of guidance for us. Heat stroke, dying of thirst, Joe refusing to ask for directions.
We are witness of the promised Messiah's birth because of God's protection and provision. He really is the Father who guides.
That's right, boss.
You bet it is.
Thank you, gentlemen. we are in a sermon series, a worship series, The Miracle of Christmas. And we're taking just a little time to slow down, to maybe stretch out Christmas a little bit, to look at the Christmas story from maybe a little bit different perspective. And last week, you heard about God's announcement. And I thank those of you who led worship last week and were able to portray the wonderfulness of how God announced, not via Facebook or email or anything like that, but instead, through angels and shepherds, God announced the birth of his son. And then he placed a star in the sky. And these astrologers, these sages, these wise people from different countries followed that star, were guided by God, and ended up at the feet of Mary and Jesus, not necessarily on Christmas Eve, but ended up there and brought gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh, and then were guided by God once again to leave. So let's look, open up your bulletins, and let's look at that for just a minute. So as you are listening to Scripture, here's my question for you. How many of these wise guys were there?
Three. We don't know.
So in the Bible, it tells me there were three. No, we have no idea how many there were. The Scripture says, and in Matthew is the only place we find any mention. Scripture says, wise men from the east came. It does not say three kings. And in fact, they probably weren't kings of anything. They were probably astrologers, professional stargazers. And they were not from anywhere close. They were from Egypt and other places that were way east of Bethlehem. Which means what? Were they Israelites? No. They were pagans. They were pagans that God called because of a star he placed that these astrologists who study the stars all the time recognized this odd thing in the sky. And they decided to follow it. And when they got there, not on Christmas Eve, when Jesus was the boy being the stable, and how do we know that? Because if you follow down, it says in verse 11, on entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, and they knelt down and worshiped him. And in a couple of weeks, we're going to hear about their escape to Egypt. And we're going to hear that Herod sent out people to kill every baby under the age of two. Because that's when he learned from the astrologists, the wise men, when the star appeared. So sometimes, even in the song that we sang, the first Noel, right? Three kings, three wise men. Our society has adopted the number three because they brought three gifts, in case you're wondering. But sometimes we get caught up so much in the little things and want to sit and argue about were there three people or not, what gifts did they bring, did they come Christmas Eve, did they really end up in the stable, or did they really end up in the house? Well, you know, the stable was attached to the house, and blah, 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 that we forget the big picture. And today, as we look at the miracle of Christmas and God's guidance, we see the big picture. The big picture is the fact that these men traveled for months and months and months, guided by a star and by God, and that God was made manifest. That's what Epiphany means. And tomorrow is Epiphany, which is when we celebrate the coming of the wise men, because at that point in time, God was made manifest, not just to the Jews and the Israelites, but he was made manifest to the world as they knew it at that point in time. Because these three men were from a different world and a different place and a different belief system. But yet God guided them to the child, to his child, to the Savior, the Messiah, so that they could take word of this birth back with them to spread across the world. So even already as a baby, an infant, a toddler, already God had planned that the entire world know about him, and that he hadn't come just for the Israelites or the Jews, but instead he had come for everybody, Gentiles included. He had come for us. And I have been reflecting on these men, these wise men that traveled, and how much they trusted this God that they didn't believe in to guide them to where God needed them to be, to see what God needed them to see. And I think about their journey and how much time they not only spent together, but that they spent kind of just wandering across the desert when you heard all kinds of things could have happened but didn't, so that God's plan could be carried out, and so that God's son and his birth could be made known to the world. We don't hear about them after this. This is it. 12 verses in Matthew is all they got. But yet it was so important that the writers of the gospel made sure it was here for us to see, for us to hear, so that we could learn. So as we look at a new year, how does God guide us? As we think about how to move forward and ahead and continue the wonderful ministry that we are doing as a congregation, what do we look for guidance, to make sure that we're on the right track? Because we're not going to take time to cross a desert on a camel. And the slowness that would have meant to their lives. Our lives are too fast-paced for that. So what do we do individually and as a congregation to make sure that we are listening for God and looking to God for guidance? And for me this year, that's Psalm 46 that we read. A psalm that was current then that I think speaks to us now, as I feel like our lives, our kingdoms are still in disarray. That the mountains are shaking and that the waters are earthquaking, and all of that that's happening is still there. And what does the psalmist say? Be still and know that I am God. Trust that I am among you. Listen for me. Look for me. Hear me. Spend time with me in word. I will make manifest to you what it is that I want you to be doing, where I want you to be going, who I want you to be touching, who I want you to tell my story to, the story of Christmas, that Emmanuel, God with us, continues to be here among us, guiding us, protecting us, sending us out. So I don't know what that looks like for you, to be still and know that I am God. I don't know what that looks like for you among your New Year's resolutions of how it is you need to grow in faith, or what it is you need to do so that you can grow in faith. I know that being here is part of it, because you get to be surrounded by your community of faith who supports you and cares about you and loves you, who wants to sit down and have a cup of coffee with you and whatever other yummies might be downstairs today. That we pray together and we come to the table together, and then we go out to live our lives separate but together. I don't know what it means for you if there is a burning desire for you to spend more time in God's Word, or to find that app like Connie and her family has that allows you to do daily devotions together as a family, even though you are in different cities miles apart. What is it that can help us as a congregation breathe and learn and see what it is that God has planned for us, not just this year, but in the years to come? Because when you're getting ready for an annual meeting, that's where your pastor's mind is, just in case you wanted to know. It's not about just today or tomorrow. It's about the next 12 months. It's about the next 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. Because the Holy Spirit is so at work here. My desire for this congregation and for myself and for each one of you is that we continue to look to God for guidance, so that God's Son and God's will can continue to be made manifest for us as individuals and as a congregation, so that we can go out back to our places and back to our homes like the wise men, chomping on an avocado sandwich and spreading the word that the Savior has been born. So my prayer is that we can journey together to take some time to breathe, to be still, to trust that God is present, and to look to Him on our journey every single day. Amen. Don't worry, Rodney, the GPS works about as well for me as it did for you. I tend to get lost a lot. Please rise as we sing this hymn together. journeying together in trust and hope, we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the forgiveness of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Gathered with all who seek the Christ child, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Faithful God, continue to provide dedicated leaders and passionate people for your church, so that wisdom and compassion in all its rich variety may be known throughout the world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creating God, your glory shines around us in every star, creature, and person. Liberate us from the ways we destroy your creation. Free us to care for the earth so that all experience your bountiful goodness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Give your justice to the leaders of the world, O God. Endow them with humble courage to defend the cause of the poor and give deliverance to those in need so that peace abounds in all countries. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
By the guidance of a star, you led the Magi to pay homage to the Christ child. Protect new families, those who live alone, travelers, especially our college students as they begin to head back, those who suffer loss, and all of others in need, including the friends and family of Cheryl, Shane and Kylie and baby Herman, Wayne and Alyssa, Randy and Rick, Dixie and Felix, Pastor Will and Virginia, Brenda and Sheila, Chick and Patty, Terry and Susan, Shell and Shelby, Peg and Sandra, and those we name in our hearts. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Ever-present one, in Jesus Christ, we boldly come before you in worship. Nurture and encourage all who gather for worship, those who serve in worship leadership roles, and all who participate in the work of faith in this community and beyond. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Generous God, throughout time, you have given us people who have shown us the gift of your grace. Inspire us by their faithfulness to serve you and all peoples. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
And God, in a time when it seems like your kingdoms are in great chaos, be with those who are suffering because of their faith. Places where violence is rapid, and those who are mourning deaths of loved ones due to shooting and other violence. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your steadfast mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated as we continue with our offering. And we are introducing a new mission of the month this Sunday, and you can read about Jerry in your bulletin as we help her with her medical expenses and her fight with cancer. please rise? Generous God, you have given us life, this community, and these gifts of earth that become the meal of your grace. Move in our hearts that we might use your gifts to bring hope and blessing wherever we go. Through Jesus our Lord. Amen. We remember that on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray together the prayer that our Lord taught us, and if you're comfortable, I invite you to hold hands with the person next to you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This meal has truly been prepared by Jesus Christ, and all are welcome to come and taste and see that the Lord is good. I invite you to be seated as communion servers prepare to serve communion. Miss Janelle, would you like to help me out this morning? She's like, "I'm not sure I heard my name." She wants to stay there? I don't blame her. I'm kind of scary. I need one person to hold the bowl, please.
Thank you.
Please rise. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for this gift of life. And we ask that you use this gift to strengthen us, to guide us in faith toward you and in love to our fellow neighbors. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before you receive the benediction, I have one more announcement. I think I had two and the other one left my brain. Bible study does begin again tomorrow, 9:30 in my office. And then instead of tomorrow night at 6 o'clock, we're going to go Tuesday night at 6 o'clock. I had something else come up that I have to be at. So tomorrow morning at 9:30 and Tuesday night at 6 o'clock, you're invited to come to Bible study. No experience necessary. Just show up. I even have extra Bibles. So there you go. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing together our closing hymn, number 302. We all need to cheer for the Vikings today. And I'm really sorry, Larry, it went a little bit later. I know he's looking down and frowning at me because the game starts at 11. Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.